Melvin.
MC in the building.
You there, Mel?
What up, what up, what up, Melly Mel?
Welcome, everyone. Give us a couple of minutes. We will be kicking it off very soon. Thank you to all my on-time people. What will we do without you? We will be beginning shortly. Good morning, everyone. Yes, it is still the morning time. I guess about 5 after 11 a.m. Welcome to the 2021 Money Smart Summit. And thank you again for your punctuality. April is Financial Literacy Month, and this is the 4th annual Money Smart Summit. It's going to be a great virtual experience. We're looking forward to taking this format next year back to the in-person physical experience. But today, this is how it's going down. My name is Melvin Coleman. I'm the executive director of the Atlanta Black Chambers. And as most of you are aware, we are an organization of entrepreneurs in the Atlanta metropolitan area. Our membership spans across the country and indeed across the world. So I'm very happy and excited to have each and every one of you join us today for the 2021 Money Smart Summit. At this time, I'm going to ask Ms. Raquel Hill to provide some Zoom instructions, some tidbits to make the experience even better. So things that for some of you who may not be as familiar with the platform, Raquel, could you please unmute at this time and drop some Zoom nuggets for us?
All right, good afternoon, everybody. This is your girl, Raquel Hill. I'm here to give you some tips and techniques to how to have the best experience here on Zoom. First of all, if you are not speaking, we ask that everyone mute their mics. If at any point someone is speaking, I may have to mute all mics and then let the speaker know that I did that so that they can unmute their mic. For your best Zoom experience, I suggest that you hit the speaker view. Hit the speaker view that allows that whomever is speaking at the time. My view has the PowerPoint in the center and the little face on the side. So if you were to hit the speaker view, the person who's speaking would be on the side and you would not see everybody moving around and being distracted. Other than that, we just ask that if you can, please cut your cameras off. If you don't need to be seen and you're not speaking today, we would love it if you would cut your cameras off, cut your mics off, and then just be prepared to learn a lot today. So I'm excited about being here.
Thank you so much, Raquel. And I'll just add, if we have, I would say, undesired background noise, somebody's not muted, then we would have to go and mute all, and then the speaker would then unmute. So that may happen a couple of times. We expect to have quite a few people attend today. So when you see that, that's just something we have to do to manage the meeting. Well, so Money Smart, the Money Smart Summit, this event is brought to you by the Atlanta Black Chambers, but more precisely stated, this event is presented by our Financial Services Committee under the direction and leadership of Ms. Sheena Robinson. So at this time, I am passing the microphone over to my sister, Sheena, please.
Good morning. Good morning, everyone. I want to thank everyone for tuning in on a Saturday morning to the Money Smart Summit. We have a jam-packed sessions today. And so we're going to go ahead and get kicked off with our panel today, which we have a prestigious panel. And we have Ms. Rebecca Ratliff, who's going to actually moderate that panel for us. And so I'm going to introduce you guys to Rebecca. Let's see. Rebecca Ratliff is a credentialed former commercial insurance claims professional with more than 25 years of experience evaluating, negotiating, and setting complex insurance claims nationwide and globally. She is the president of the Atlanta Association of Insurance Professionals and a proud active member of the ABC and other local national organizations. Rebecca is a mediator, arbitrator with the Judicial Mediation Arbitration Service, JAMS. She is the first African-American female non-attorney ever to be confirmed to the JAMS panel, providing service worldwide. Rebecca is the second vice chair of the National Bar Association's Alternative Dispute Resolution Section and the Diversity Committee Chair, co-chair of the American Bar Association's Dispute Resolution Section. She is a nationally sought after presenter, panelist, and lecturer in the insurance and legal industries. Rebecca is a recipient of various prestigious awards, to include a 7th U.S. District, which is Illinois, Congressional Award for her work in alternative dispute resolution. Rebecca is a native of Chicago, Illinois, and of the University of Illinois at Urbana, holding a BA degree in the discipline of psychology. She is based in Atlanta, Georgia, and she operates internationally. So without further ado, I want to welcome Ms. Rebecca Ratliff, and she's going to introduce the rest of the panel to you guys.
Thank you, Sheena, and thank you, Melvin, for having me this morning. Good morning, Atlanta Black Chambers. It's good to be with you on this rainy morning in Atlanta. First, I'd like to start off by introducing our amazing panelists. They're going to spend 30 seconds introducing themselves, and then we're going to dive into the discussion. So if you would, Evan, go ahead and introduce yourself. Is Evan up and ready? Let's move to Jasmine, and we'll go back to Evan.
I'm here.
Oh, go, Evan. Hey there. Good morning.
Good morning. How are you?
Good.
My apologies. I have painters down at the store, so I had to make sure they got the lockbox code.
Okay. But
thank you for having me this morning. My name's Evan Grant. I'm the owner of Mr. Bath and Spas and Royal Spa of Atlanta. We are an authorized dealer for some of the top manufacturers in the country for hot tub solutions, walk-in tub solutions, shower. Our motto is advanced and alternative healing, safety, and cleanliness.
Thank you. Welcome, Evan. Jasmine?
Good morning, everybody. My name's Jasmine Smith. I reside in Anchorage, Alaska. I'm originally from Savannah, Georgia, but I'm in Anchorage right now. I own a company called Baby Vend LLC. We specialize in custom-made vending machines geared towards traveling families ages 5 and younger and lactating mothers. So we do specialty vending and consulting and technology.
Awesome. Thank you. Welcome, Jasmine. Terry.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Terry Lawson Adams. I am the owner of Ellsworth Healthcare Staffing. We provide healthcare staffing for healthcare facilities as well as schools. Anyone that needs healthcare professionals, we are their provider and we provide services here in the Metro Atlanta area.
Thank you. Welcome, Terry. And last but certainly not least, Javier.
Hello, I'm Javier McIntosh. I own McIntosh Bros Productions. We do full service video productions such as commercials, music videos, short films, and feature films. And I also am the co-founder of freely.tv. That's freely.tv. That is a African-American streaming platform for African-American content of over 52 channels that we launched during the quarantine.
Awesome. Thank you. And welcome, Javier. So you're in for a treat, everybody. Just ride with us for a minute. We're going to take you on a little safari with us, and you'll understand why I'm calling it a safari. Once upon a time, there was Pandemica, and it cast a shadow over the whole globe and all the people who were affected by it. But Black people figured out how to thrive despite the unprecedented challenges. They stuck together, they helped each other, and emerged stronger. You're about to hear from four entrepreneurs from varied generations and industries who reimagined their businesses and were able to pivot and thrive during a pandemic. I hope you're inspired by their stories. I am. So let's dive in. When the pandemic struck, Evan, what struggles did you have?
Well, first off, during the pandemic, my wife was expecting our first child. So she came into this world on June 9th. And so that was scary. You know, we were at the hospital without family, without friends for 4 days. So that was the highlight of my year. But during that course of time, I was still trying to figure out how to keep the business afloat, how to not panic, how to stay focused. And the reason that I had to go through that is the industries that I serviced, there was supply chain shortages for hot tubs. People were at home and they, you know, those things that they had been putting off with home improvement all of a sudden became more of a priority. In addition to that, the mode of the way that I like to conduct business, which is direct to consumer, that was deemed non-essential by the state of Georgia. Going into people's homes and in their bathroom, it wasn't something the state was comfortable with. So I had to figure out, what am I going to do so that I can continue to sell my products, service my customers, and also protect my family and my customers' families at the same time.
Yeah, big challenge. Jasmine, what struggles did you have when the pandemic struck?
I had to take my camera and my mute off. My number one struggle was, first and foremost, just being a single parent and for suddenly having my children 24/7 with nowhere else for them to go, but also the realization that my business was built around the tourism and the travel industry. And, you know, seemingly overnight, people weren't going anywhere, nor were they encouraged to go anywhere. So on top of trying to juggle, just now I have my twins home full time, and that's the number one priority.
Across the street.
Everybody,
oh.
Mute, please, if you're not speaking. Oh. Thank you.
So trying to just pivot that experience, but also the realization that I had built my business and my industry around something that we just weren't being encouraged to do anymore. And then, you know, kind of on closing on top of that, you know, here in Anchorage, our mayor put us on a strict lockdown and told everybody to stay home unless you absolutely had somewhere to go. So literally for about 2 to 3 months, I literally could not run my business. And I had to just kind of strategize what was going to happen next and just survivability and just accessing some of our vending locations.
Wow. Yeah, that's a lot. And you had twins. Terry, share with us what struggles you had initially when the pandemic struck.
We are a healthcare staffing agency, and we also provide home care services. Right in January, we've gotten a contract with DeKalb County to provide home care services. And we were doing home care services. We were also staffing at assisted living facilities and nursing homes. And that was our primary focus. When the pandemic hit, just like Evan, the state sent notice that no one can go into other people's homes, and our home care services was placing CNAs in the homes of elderly or senior citizens. And so we had to stop that business. And then our assisted living facilities that we were servicing, as well as our nursing homes, they were basically, their census was low. A lot of people were taking their loved ones out of the facilities because they had so much COVID in all those facilities. So we had lost 98% of our business, like overnight. By, I guess it was March, mid-March, our business was just gone, it seemed. But we survived.
So perception is everything. Thank you, Javier. What initial struggles did you have when the pandemic struck?
Yes, so our business is video production. So most of it is in-person filming and then editing. So we had to transition from all of the in-person stuff, pretty much the bigger projects that kind of we usually produce, to more of real estate, more of we interact with one person or less, go into a home, film it. We did more drone work. We did more graphic design stuff. More animation. So we still stayed within, you know, video production, but we did a strong pivot to what we usually do.
Thank you. You've heard some key words here. You've heard fear from Evan, which in our prep, I so admired that he just came on out and said fear. Go ahead. If you have fear, you have to face it. That's the only way you can get past it. You also heard Jasmine talk about how her business was centered around travel, movement, people on the go, and then that just got shut down, really, not just in the country, but all over the world. And then Terry talked about how 98% of her business was lost, or so it seemed. Now keep that in mind as we go through this talk. And then Javier is in a business where in-person production was the way they operated, and he said pivot. And so we know sometimes you have to pivot, and that's the turn. You don't just leave the whole, you don't leave the whole highway. You just maybe have to change lanes. And so just keep that in mind as we talk. So Javier, you're the last one to talk. Go right into how you overcame the challenges. You kind of touched on it just now.
Yes. Yeah, so there's always been challenges with our business. it's up and down flow. Like sometimes it's a huge month and sometimes it's low. So I think, you know, me being in business for 10 years, I'm used to the big lulls. This one just happened to be a really big low and something we had to really think about and overcome. But I think mentally I'm used to the ups and downs, and just conveying that with my team that, hey, we're gonna have to do some things differently for the next few months until we get through it. We didn't know that it was gonna be this long, but I think just having that positive mentality that we're going to get through it was the big thing that we try to do.
And you even mentioned real estate. Can you define what that looks like in the film industry, film and editing industry?
Yeah. So real estate is one of the things that is for us, the lowest level of contact. Either we go inside a house and we bring our camera equipment, we film it all. Usually we either or just interacting with a real estate person that's opened up the house and they leave, or, you know, there's like, you know, a process where we could just get in. So it was something where we could go in there, film it with a one person crew or a two person crew, or just be from the outside and film it on our drone and fly it up and get the outside of the house. So it's a super low contact filming process for us. So we decided to double down on that.
Safe. Okay. So Jasmine, how did you overcome the challenges? And by the way, so Javier touched a little bit on technology. You mentioned the drones, Javier, and you also mentioned your app. Because one of the questions, of course, is how did you leverage technology? And I'll tackle that with you real quick, Javier, and before I move on to Jasmine, we can save a little time. Say the name of your app again, and then I'm gonna ask you to put it in the chat. Yes, especially if it's open to, you know, if anybody can use it.
Yeah, so it's freely.tv. That's, I'll put it in the chat, freely.tv. And it's on Android, it's on iOS, it's on Fire TV. And we're doing 100% growth every month. And we realized we were, you know, in pre-production before the quarantine, a couple months before the quarantine of doing the app and creating it. And then once the quarantine happened, we said, oh, people are really, really needing content to consume, especially African-American content. So we decided to double down on it. And we focused in on that. It's me, my brother, and three other founders. And basically we took that app and created African-American content. So it's over 52 channels of streaming content. So it was a blessing in disguise. I think with every challenge, there's an opportunity. And this was of our opportunity.
That's right. That's right. There's opportunity in adversity. Absolutely. If you're paying attention. So now we'll move to Jasmine. And how did you overcome the challenges, Jasmine? And how did you leverage technology?
Yeah. So you know what? I love that question. So for us, it was looking inside at our processes and the opportunities that we had that could be shareable. And then looking at the deficiencies in our community. So like Anchorage specifically, we couldn't go anywhere. People weren't thinking about travel. They weren't thinking about vending machines. But in that process, I'm like, well, people always look at the vending industry as like a side hustle, but we actually have a lot of moving parts, which requires us to be very thorough logistically. And for a little while there, we pivoted our work in terms of not even doing vending machines. We ended up reaching out to like the local government and the city and those places and saying, our company is advanced at logistics and moving pieces and putting it together. We have some great wholesale partnerships. Can we consult and help you work through the city crisis? Because it looks like you guys also don't really know what you're doing and don't have a vision or strategy. So our pivot was literally just two things. Number one, taking a break from vending for a while and just doing what we had to do to survive, which resulted in other COVID-related government contracts and consulting them on their own processes and wholesale for like PPE supplies and things. But then it was also me realizing that although I was in crisis and panicked about not being able to do my business, recognizing that we weren't going to be in a pandemic forever. And then I saw the opportunity that eventually folks are going to come out of the pandemic and they're going to want to travel more than ever. So then we use that time to work on our brand and our long-term strategy and our kind of our new direction post-COVID.
We're super important. And again, common threads that you're hearing, fear, panic. I love the transparency of our panelists. You know, we all have a lot of the same concerns, and it's really important to drill down. The only way you can fix it is if you understand what you're dealing with. So, and of course I'm a mediator, so I'm an expert at drilling down and finding out what really is the root of the problem. So you're gonna hear more about that. So Evan, how did you overcome your challenges and how did you leverage technology?
So the first thing, as I mentioned, the government deemed bath remodeling, which is a core part of the business, is going in people's homes. They deemed that non-essential. So I had to find a different way to get the data that I need in order to accurately estimate a job. And also to have that human interaction with the customer, which is, for me, it's the key in, you know, completing a transaction where you're going to a customer's house and you're asking them for $10,000, $15,000, $20,000 on the first day. So how do you do that without being able to spend time in their home at the kitchen table, let them get a good feel of you, let them check you out? So what I did is I put together a PowerPoint presentation that walk the customer through all the product line, all of the options, give them some kind of industry data. If they had never done a bath remodel or never owned a hot tub, whatever that, or a walk-in tub, whatever that product was, in that presentation was all the information that they needed to make a well-informed decision. And then at the end of it, you know, go over financing and payment options. I was able to complete quite a few transactions. I was actually shocked at how well I did. I would have liked to do better, but I wasn't busy. And so that's what really kind of drove me crazy, was not being busy. not having my opportunity to get out the house and, you know, be in the streets, going to my favorite restaurants and hanging out with my customers, making friends. I enjoy what I do for a living. So what I did to overcome those challenges was I went to explore the areas around my community that I knew were around here. I kind of knew it was there, but I hadn't really got to enjoy them. Places like Lake Allatoona, Red Top Mountain. I needed that for my mental well-being so that I wouldn't lose it with everything that was going on in the world with the pandemic, everything going on with violence against Black men. My daughter coming to the world, I got to take care of me in order to get through this. I got to make sure my marriage is going to stay together. So again, finding ways that I could work outdoors. I found hot spots around the lake and little nooks where I could pull out a picnic chair, get on my laptop, get some fresh air, be able to see other people, keep my distance, and also have some space. So that was helpful for me. We documented. We have a customer portal that we signed up for with a company called Thrive. And that customer interactions with the customer pretty much 24/7. They could send pictures of their current bathroom to me. They could send measurements. We could ask questions back and forth to complete the sales process. I also use that time to hire a research team. I often have leaned on myself in my prior sales experience to make decisions because I trust myself, but I had the time to really investigate what do those companies that you're striving to do, what are some of the things that they're doing that you're not doing? And now that you got some free time, you can kind of shift your focus. So I hired a research team to put together a business plan summary that did all the research across the country down to the local market to make me feel extremely confident that I was on the right path, I was making the right decisions, and soon I'll be able to take that down to a bank for funding.
Evan, okay, so your answer is loaded. It's loaded. I took so many good notes from your talk. You talked about self-care, and a lot of us have still to understand that how you care for yourself enables how you care for your business. And personal care is directly related to professional care. You cannot thrive if you are just surviving. And there is a difference between surviving and thriving. You also figured out how to do your business differently. You reimagined your business for how to interact with your customers and how to be a solution to a business need. You have to be the solution to a business need. You did your research. You did a business plan. Now, the entrepreneurs on the line, how many of you don't have a business plan? If you do not, right after you file your taxes, get you a business plan, because a business plan will save your professional life. It is a projection of the SWOT analysis, your strengths, your weaknesses, your opportunities, and your threats. If you don't have a business plan, you operate in raggedy. So really, really reconsider that. Just load it, personal and professional care. So let's go to Terry now. I know you have some nuggets, Terry. How did you overcome the challenges in your business and how did you leverage technology?
Well, as I indicated, the majority of our business was home care services, as well as staffing at assisted living facilities and nursing homes. So once we lost 98% of our business, we were really nervous and scared, but I decided, you know what, I'm going to make this work. We're going to figure it out. So we continued to call lots of our clients, old and new clients, to see if they needed staffing assistance. And we got one client who lost all of their staff except three people because they had so much COVID in their facility. So we started hiring more people, sending people there. Of course, it was hard. We were working almost around the clock because people would go to the facility. They see paramedics come, even if it's to pick someone up from dialysis. They're scared, they leave, they quit in the middle of the shift. So we were like, it was a revolving door. And we were continuing to do it because it was like, okay, what else are we gonna do? At the same time, I started thinking, I had my staff working on that. I started thinking, how can we survive during COVID? So we thought about, okay, we're healthcare staffing. We can do COVID-related services. Now, a lot of the hospitals were actually cutting people shifts and laying some of the people off because all of the elective service surgeries were stopped during COVID. And so if you weren't in ER and doing something COVID related, most likely you were out of work. So a lot of the nurses were calling us looking for work. And so we thought, okay, what can we do? So we started calling around and we found various clients. One of our biggest clients is a manufacturing warehouse. They manufacture art supplies. And they knew that during COVID, parents were home with their kids and they needed to do something with them. And art supplies demand went up. But in order for them to operate, they needed to keep their facility safe. So our answer was, we can help you keep your facility safe. We have nurses that can be there to do temperature checks, COVID screening, as well as if there was any first aid issues. And so they hired us. We staffed so many nurses there and we're still staffing there. Now it's cut back a little bit, but that was our first thing. Then when school started talking about trying to go back, we started contacting them. We have nurses now at COVID clinics at schools. We have nurses at regular COVID clinics. We've doing temperature screening, COVID testing. We just got a subcontract with the biggest healthcare staffing company in the US to help with COVID related services. And we're gonna do that through hopefully next year. We know that it's a six month renewal, but we actually in 2020, we made more money than we made in 2019.
That's right. You go. This is, our guests, our friends, our 84 of our closest friends are on this Zoom, and they didn't get to hear the stories and the conversation we had in our prep. But me hearing this for the second time just makes me even more inspired. So, Javier, what did you realize about yourself in this past year, and what does the future look like? Because we're listening to Terry talk about how her pivot was COVID-related services. And I'll tell you, I have a friend in California who was in beauty supply, but she figured out how to be an essential business and started selling masks and PPE. She got herself certified. There is a way to pivot and thrive during this time. You just have to, maybe what you need to is a mentor. A closed mouth doesn't get fed. Sometimes you have to have a conversation. Some of us are too embarrassed to share with somebody that we're in crisis. So find somebody you trust. That's another thing. If you don't have a mentor, get one. You need a business mentor. And you can have more than one, somebody inside your industry and somebody outside your industry who will tell you the truth about you, what they see. That kind of feedback is magical. And I can promise you that we all consult those of us who are in business and on this panel, consult with somebody about, even if it's God, and it should be, by the way, consult with somebody so that you can figure out your next logical steps. So Javier, what did you realize about yourself? This is important. That's why I touched on mentorship. What did you realize about yourself in this past year? And what does the future look like? Oh, you're on mute.
Okay, perfect. I really like that you combine those two things together, what I learned about myself and mentorship, because I did something that is directly related to both of those. So during the quarantine, while I had this time, I'm part of an accelerator program. It's called Entrepreneurship Accelerator. And the Entrepreneurship Organization is the parent organization of that. And to be in that organization, you have to have a million plus yearly revenue in your business. So what I did is I reached out to a lot of the people in the parent company and said, hey, I'm growing my business. We're in the quarantine. I'd love to just pick your mind. And while we have some downtime, pick your mind and just learn a few things. Can we set up an hour call to go over? So I had my personal assistant reach out to like 100 of those. And out of those, about like 15 to 20, we actually had a phone call. And I learned so much. A lot of it is the mental aspect of fighting through to get your business to grow. And they kind of taught me their individual strategies, and I implemented on each call. I said, hey, I'm implementing this one or two strategies to grow my business. And actually two of those people end up being clients because they were like, oh, wow, I actually need video production. Can we continually mentor you? And can I hire you for some videos? So that's kind of what I did. And I learned about just even, I knew it already, but just how important the mental aspect of growing your business is just from people I respect and that they put the importance on it.
It's everything. The game is played in this arena. That's what people don't understand. It's, you know, you can imagine anything you want. We're going to, in one of the next points, we're going to bring that out because that's a really important point. Thank you for that. Talking about mentality. Terry, what did you realize about yourself in this past year, and what does the future look like?
I realized that basically it is all in believing in yourself and working hard. And I realized that, you know, any challenge you can turn into opportunity, and which we did. I also, just like Javier said, I acquired two mentors. I'm a member of the American Staffing Association, which is the largest staffing association in the US. And I reached out to, I looked at the larger healthcare staffing companies and I thought, let me reach out to them. And I got a mentor with two of the largest companies, staffing companies in the US. And so they've helped me throughout the pandemic. And I meet with each one, each of my two mentors once a month. And so it's really, really helped me. And I just learned, you know, to just continue fighting and pressing on, And my future, I think, looks great because connecting with the mentors as well as getting the contract with AMN, I think is going to help us. And I'm just learning and growing and looking forward to the end of this year to see how well we're going to do. I know we're going to do better than last year. So I'm excited.
I'm excited for you. Someone is not muted. If you are not speaking, please mute yourself. Okay. Yep, please mute. Thank you so much. So Jasmine, tell us what you realized about yourself in this past year and what the future looks like. And I know you're going to also give some tips on a couple apps. Go ahead.
Yeah, I could start off with the technology. I didn't answer that in the last piece. So for my business, the two technology pieces that we use a lot that are very helpful is, of course, we use Slack. I'm honestly not a big fan of Slack, but my team loves Slack because they could talk all the time on different topics and keep up with the topics. So we're really big Slackers in that good sense. And then also Monday is a really good online software that I love. It's great. It's like a good combination of like project management, team management, task functions, and flow charts. So we swear by Monday, easy to use platform, easy to learn. So in terms of what I learned about myself, so Slack is a communication tool where you can have different chats and groups and, you know, share documents, and it's kind of, it's almost like an intensive messenger, but it's more towards like multiple teams and topics and business. So Slack, and I can put it in the chat too. And then Monday is like the team management, project management software that we use that really helped us not being able to physically be together. It also kind of helped me with the work-life balance because I didn't see all these messages constantly in my inbox on my cell phone. Slack is a separate app on my phone, so I could turn it off when I was ready and done. So in terms of what I learned about myself in the past year and what the future looks like, I think I just got reaffirmed in who I was as a business owner and a person. And I think the pandemic really reminded me that there's literally nothing I can't do if I don't want to do it. And I literally own my future. And I think about our conversation when I was saying about it really taught me to see my goals through it, not to it, and go beyond that first goal and keep going. But I don't know, I can't stress enough to people, like our business was doing maybe five figures. And I realized it was kind of a mindset because I'm trying to figure out how we went from five figures to seven and getting, we got a $2 million contract during the pandemic with the city. And then we just renewed for another $3.5 million contract with the city. And we leveraged again our expertise and pretty much helping the city determine how they're going to handle COVID and all the moving pieces. And we just really took that from running a vending machine company and them trusting and seeing that. And I just stress to people that when I look at my story, like being a single mom, being here in Anchorage and living in literally the poorest neighborhood in the city, but I'm here by choice because I feel like having my business headquartered out of here, seeing all the kids in this neighborhood and reminding them that, you know, no matter where you are, what you're going through, your environment can do good things. I think I was reconnected to that during the pandemic, and then just kind of seeing the potential, and that motivated me on my toughest day to like just remember what I was doing all this for my kids and then all the other kids and people in our neighborhood who are always told we're less than. And then when I think about our future, I know it looks good and it's going to be good because I feel like I have the power to make it good and I see it. And you know, going through COVID and being like, wow, Jasmine, you went from being immobilized to thinking, what are we going to do, to just, you cried it out, you got through it. Your kids drove you crazy. I didn't think I was going to make it with them some days. We couldn't sled enough. We sled every day, you know, because that's all what we could do. To seeing this business pivot, it just really reminded me, like, I really have more control and opportunities, and it's in my mindset, in my actions, and how I lead my team. So I just was reconnected to that over the past year. And I just encourage others to just don't sleep on the power of yourself and what you can do when you really want to do it and your back's against the wall, you start making changes.
So key, comfort zone, stay out of it. Stay out of your comfort zone. Everybody that you're listening to this morning was really out of their comfort zone, including me. Imagine a non-lawyer in the legal field and then COVID struck. So stay out of your comfort zone. Government contracts. You just heard Jasmine mention that she got a government contract. Consider getting yourself certified as a minority business enterprise and or a women's business enterprise. Consider that. Right here in Georgia, we have the National Minority Supplier Development Council, Georgia chapter here. So just keep that in mind. There are ways to create more opportunities for your business. And last but not least, Evan, what did you realize about yourself in this past year, and what does the future look like?
I'd probably say the top thing is I began to trust myself. Almost 100%, you know, I don't have that doubt anymore that I used to have with other business ventures that I had. When things weren't going the right way, then I would let the universe tell me that maybe I'm not supposed to do this, you know? And so during this year, I realized that I'm willing to use all of my talents, all of my resources. If I got to tap back in something I did 5 years ago, 10 years ago, to fill gaps, help me get what I need to build my business, I'm going to do it. And I left something out in the previous topic, you know, what did I do to adapt? You know, I went back and took a sales job working for a guy that I know is half as smart and half as talented as me, but he's got a company and it's a reputable company. And I went and did some work for him for about 2 months or so, when I was experiencing those raw material shortages and I couldn't get people the products that they wanted. That'd probably be.
Uh-oh, you went on, Evan, you just went on mute after you said raw material shortage.
My hand accidentally hit the mouse pad. I realized I'm mentally tougher than I ever could have imagined. If I could have foreseen 2020 and 2019, I would have never thought that I would be coming out on the side that I'm on right now, which is a good side. What I did and what I've been doing for a long time, and it worked for me very well last year, is to stop focusing on all the negative stuff. Most people that know me know that I'm an eternal optimist. I can always find a silver lining, you know, what good is going to come out of this. And what good came out of it for my company is that a lot of that free time I had, I was driving up and down the highways in Georgia, scouting properties. I knew that you know, there was going to be a shift. My pastor kept saying there was going to be a wealth shift, you know, that the people, there were going to be lots of people who were wealthy, who were running businesses, who really didn't deserve those opportunities, and people who deserve those opportunities, been breaking their neck, been top performers within their companies, been overlooked for opportunities, that there was going to be a shift. And I felt like I was one of those people. And I believed in that. And so I looked at for opportunities. Long story short, I ended up negotiating a retail space where they were in October when I finally figured out this is exactly, and this was also based on that business plan that I had written. They had researched that area that I was eyeballing. They looked at the demographics. They looked at the money. They looked at the foot traffic. And once I knew 100% that that's what I wanted, I still didn't. I just kept my eye on it, expressed my interest. And in about a 5-month period, that space was still on the market. And it wasn't until, say, February of this year that I decided to go ahead and sign that lease after they came to me and said, we're going to give you this $6,000 per month, 3,400 square feet facility. We're going to give that to you for $3,700 for the first 12 months. We're going to give you the first 3 months for free. So you got time to get your inventory and everything together. We're going to break down this 6,000 over 5 years so that you can gradually work your way up to the full payment. So only by the grace of God. And again, you know, keeping focused on the positive and being ready when the opportunity presented itself.
Right. It's not Sunday, it's Saturday, but anybody saying hallelujah and amen? Because I will tell you, the next conversation that you're going to hear from our panelists is about the ancestors. And I hope you listen to this very carefully. I'm the daughter of a pastor and a poet. And so this is what you're going to get as we go into that next quick talk segment. The Bible says that faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. So it mentions hope as a part of faith. Hope is positive expectation and belief. Well, belief is hope with a component of entitlement to it. I hope you feel entitled. It's part of our inheritance. We are Black people. We survived the slave trade. We can do anything. But you have to have that positive mentality. You have to believe. So panelists, what is your connection to the ancestors? Evan, I'm gonna let Jasmine go first. Jasmine just sent me a note. I'm gonna let Jasmine go first. Jasmine, what is your connection to the ancestors and the impact on your life because of it?
Yes. So on my side, when I'm not working, I'm an avid genealogist in my family. I love looking up my family, my ancestors. I go through census records, military draft records. I go through everything. And I believe in that. And I believe in them so much because it reminds me I'm never alone. So no matter what I'm doing, no matter what I'm praying, I'm having a good day, a bad day, you know, knowing who they are, what they went through, where they came from, successes and struggles, that keeps me going. And so for me, knowing their names and their stories and where they came from, that's my source of inspiration. So I never feel like I'm alone because I feel like they have my back. There's a whole army of folks right there that are helping me and guiding me in my decisions. And I've taught my kids that practice as well, to also be able to channel ancestors, they're your family, and, you know, find your strength in stories and knowing that whatever you're going through today, there was some tears, smiles, weddings, divorces, reuniting, broken families, and all that before you. So this is just a part of the process.
That's exactly right. Maya Angelou used to talk about the 10,000 ancestors that walked into a room with her whenever she went somewhere. And I feel that. I feel that. I feel like I'm never alone when I walk into a room. Evan, go ahead and share your connection to the ancestors. You're on mute. Uh-oh. I thought you were frozen. You're not. Okay, go ahead, Evan.
All right, had some trouble unmuting. So I'm a native of California, but I've been in Georgia since 2005. My parents sent me and a younger sister of mine who wanted to go to a Black college out here in 2005. They bought a townhouse right outside of downtown, and they gave us a leg up to start a life in Atlanta during a very young period in my life, but exciting, you know, 2005 Atlanta. I didn't know how rich my history was in the state of Georgia until last year. During the pandemic, I got on ancestry.com and you know, completed a family tree. A lot of that stuff was already built by other family members, but I was able to go a little bit further, you know, as far back as, you know, the early 1800s, and I traced my family to Lithonia. And, you know, I even found some census records, you know, that list, you know, some of my great, great uncles and aunts, you know, about 10 of them living in one house. The city at that time was called Honey Creek. And I think it's either Lithonia or Conyers. I try to Google Earth the property, but it's like an empty field now. I'm saying all of this to say that I'm supposed to be here in Georgia. I left here probably three times. I've been in Tennessee. I went back to California. I tried a small stint in Texas, but something keeps bringing me back to Atlanta. And now that I'm married and now that I have a child, like, this will be my home for a long time to come. But what has been sweet to me this last few months especially is the realization that my ancestors were working in fields, you know, living, you know, being beaten, not being looked at like, you know, a normal human being, you know. And now I've got this opportunity to kind of get retribution, you know, to be one of the first. I don't know of, and if you guys know, tell me, and I'm not saying to toot my own horn, but I don't know of anyone else locally, a Black man running a hot tub store, you know, selling walk-in tubs. I know a lot of bath remodelers and whatnot, but so that gives me a lot of sense of pride that I get to give the next generation of my family, my nephews who are here from California, my sister. I've got a brother-in-law that just moved down here 3 weeks ago to help out with the business from Indiana, and he's going to be moving his family out here. But it makes me feel really good to come for my family to come from Georgia, what I'm doing today, and how I'm building a legacy for generations and branches off of my family for a lifetime.
It's legacy time. It's legacy time. Absolutely. Javier, what's your connection to the ancestors?
So my connection is, it's also connected to my superpower.
I think we didn't get there yet. Hang on.
We didn't get there. Okay.
You're preempting me.
I'm preempting. But it's not lost on me that everything that we do right now, it's because we are on the shoulders of giants, of our ancestors, that they really helped us get these stepping stones and everything that we do. So I think it really puts me in perspective every day that I have a big challenge or something's let down or something's horrible going down. I think back, like, if my ancestors looked at me now, they're like, that's not a stress. You just keep going. That's nothing. Everything in your life is happiness compared to what we had to go through, what was before. So it really just puts me in perspective. I pray three times a day and I think back to everything that I'm thankful of. And it's just the little things, like the opportunities that we have right now. And it's because of our ancestors, because everything they went through.
That's right. That's right. Terry, sis, tell us what your connection to the ancestors is. And then we're going to round out this panel and blow everybody's mind. Go.
Okay, well, my connection to the ancestors is also remembering that my ancestors went through so much to get me where I am today. And that, as Javier said, when we complain about little things, they, you know, they're looking at us saying, what are you complaining about? Things were so much more difficult for them. But also, I think we talked about this before, where my connection also is, I think about how my grandfather always instilled in me, you know, create generational wealth. Don't always save, never owe anyone anything. And so when the pandemic hit, I was prepared because I knew financially, if I needed to walk away, I'd save money. I didn't owe anybody anything, so I can walk away. But I had enough money saved to hold me over until things turned around. So I think, you know, ancestors, they knew how to save. They knew how to save because they didn't have much, so they could stretch a dollar. And so I kind of grew up learning how to stretch a dollar and to save. And I appreciate it because it's based on, I mean, because of my grandfather and the stuff that he's taught me, I think I am where I am today. And I appreciate everything that our ancestors went through to get us where we are here today and giving us the opportunities that we have.
So important. So as we end this panel and leave a nugget, 30 seconds or less, what is your superpower? What is your superpower, Terry?
My superpower is helping others.
Jasmine, your superpower?
My superpower is my vision and visions.
Javier, we don't have time to explore that. That's a conversation for another day. Javier, another gift from the ancestors. Javier, what is your superpower?
My superpower is my optimism.
Awesome. And Evan, what is your superpower? Oh, are you on mute? There you go.
Javier, we're right in line with the same thing. I feel like I'm not relenting. I will not give up. I'm determined. There's nothing that you can do to stop me. I'm going to make my company a success one way or the other.
That's right. Yes, sir. That's right. By any means necessary.
By any means.
That's right. So everybody in hearing distance of this Zoom, here are some parting words. Success is a series of decisions. Ask yourself, what is your vision for your business? How will you move forward in the face of unprecedented adversity? What is the force that drives you? Last words, people of Wakanda, every morning in Africa, a lion awakes and it knows that it has to outrun the fastest gazelle or it will go hungry. The gazelle knows that it must outrun the fastest lion or it will be eaten. The moral of the story is whether you are a lion or gazelle, when the sun comes up, you better be running. Thank you for joining us today.
Well, let me jump in and say thank you so much. These are all members of the Atlanta Black Chambers, the panelists, the moderator. And so that was a showcase for those of you who may not be aware of how dynamic our membership is. Evan Grant, Mr. Bath and Spas, Jasmine Smith, Baby Vend. And I know everybody wants to know what's in the vending machines. Maybe you can put that in the chat, Jasmine. Shout out to one of our tenured members, Ms. Terry Lawson Adams of Ellsworth Healthcare. And then my main man, Javier McIntosh. McIntosh Bros Productions. Thank you so much for that panel. We really enjoyed it. Sheena, what do we have next on tap?
All right, that was very, very, very powerful. Now we're gonna bring up our vendors. And so we're gonna bring up our first vendor. I'm gonna give the floor to Mr. Matthew Coleman with Via Capital Lending. So Matthew, if you wanna go ahead and take the stage.
Sorry about that. I was getting set up. First of all, my name is Matthew Coleman. And, you know, being a proud member of the Atlanta Black Chamber has been, you know, just been great. And obviously working with Sheena and the Financial Service Committee, you know, gives me an opportunity to support in any way possible. VI Capital Lending is a company I started 3 years ago. I was in the construction field for a while and saw the need amongst my peers for lending. Really had a great mentor. Basically what VI Capital Lending does is we broker loans for a few services that we offer. One is gonna be your fix and flip loans. Second is going to be new construction.
That's a big thing right now, obviously, with the housing shortage. Another thing we do that people aren't really aware of is that we do cash out refinances. So if you own property that's free and clear, you know, we have an opportunity to be able to pull that cash out as high as 80% of the value. So right now it's a really competitive market. Another service that we offer is just purchase. If you're looking to purchase a turnkey rental property, rates are as low as 4.25%, 4% for business loans. So it's really a creative aspect that we bring to the table. So when we say VI, VI stands for vision it. You know, one of the things I try to do with my clients is really be more of a consultant, not just someone who, you know, moves the paper around, but as a builder as well, I'm able to look at the complexities of what they're going through from the lending side and the things that they're going to need to move that loan forward. And then also from the building side, some of the issues that they might have with subs, and then also withdraws and moving the project forward. So again, you know, my opportunity to be a part of Atlanta Black Chamber and listen to, you know, all those inspiring stories that we were speaking to earlier. You know, I think we all as entrepreneurs and in the chamber being small businesses and trying to scale, it's been great over the last 3 years, just seeing certain members grow and scale. Me being one of them, I've had a lot of growth over the pandemic and have really learned so much. So, you know, when you're looking to do any construction work, fix and flip, when you're looking to purchase rental property, if you need some cash and you have property that you can, you know, kind of pull that money out, you can give me a call. I do consulting as well. One of the things with VI being that we vision it, we want to find the right loan for you. And as much as, you know, you go and you order something, you know, whether you order a hamburger, you know, it's not that simple. Do you want lettuce? Do you want tomatoes? Do you want sesame seed? You know, the bun. So it's a lot of different complexities to the loan industry, as we know in the financial services committee we talk about. So with this Money Smart event and the thing that Sheena and the chamber we do every year, I'm so glad that everyone came out and I'm glad that I was able to sponsor and be a part of it. So you can reach me. I did not have a chance. I was getting that together, Sheena. You can reach me at 678-870-4331. And then my email is MBC, my initials, at vicapitallending.com. Thank you so much for the time.
Awesome. Thank you, Matt. And Matt, if you can, go ahead and post your information in the chat.
Yes, sir.
Okay. If you can go ahead, the information you just said, if you can go ahead and put that in the chat, we'll greatly appreciate it, okay? All right, so we're going to move right along to our next vendor. As Matthew said, we do appreciate our vendors for their support and definitely know within the Financial Services Committee, we are a great team of professionals who provide excellent service. So please reach out to Matthew Coleman if you find that his services are a great fit for you. Our next vendor, we have actually two, it's a two-man show, and I'm not sure which one's going to present, but we have Mr. Rico McCambry and Hazik Ali. They're also going to be a part of the breakout sessions today, but you're going to learn a little bit about their business with Nove LLC. So you guys have the floor. Are y'all unmuted?
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, I was talking, but I wasn't. Sheena, this is Rico. Can you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Awesome. So yeah, you know, we are new members to the Atlanta Black Chamber. So, you know, incredible information so far, and the few people that we met so far, it's been incredible, and we're definitely looking forward to our experience here. My name is Rico McCambry, and I'm the president and CEO of this company that we call Nove. Today, I'm going to be joined with Mr. Hazik Ali. He's the chief marketing officer, and we're going to be discussing in our breakout session how to access capital, and we're going to be giving you five little known secrets to rapidly acquire $50,000 to $250,000 in capital for your business. So we're going to definitely be a compliment to what Matthew's doing. And congratulations, Matthew, on everything you're doing for businesses across the country. But it doesn't matter if you're a startup business or if you've been in business for years, we have a solution for you. I've been blessed to write articles on business credit and funding for Forbes.com and also a part of Forbes Business Council. So you don't want to miss what we have in store. But we're also incredibly blessed to have Hazik here with us, who's going to be sharing some words of wisdom because he started his entrepreneurship journey in junior high school, believe it or not. He was actually featured on an episode of 60 Minutes and has been an entrepreneur all of his life, producing millions of dollars in revenue in his venture. So Hazik, give them a few reasons why they want to make sure they hang out and actually come to our breakout session.
Yeah, I'm really excited, man. And first, you know, I just think it's really incredible. Even, you know, it's cool working with you because you're so humble and down to earth and all of that. But just watching all of your accomplishments and just being able to watch you explode, not just as a family man, but as a visionary on this Atlanta scene, has just been incredible. And I'm just honored to be here. And I'm so proud to be a part of this Atlanta Black Chamber because let's face it, y'all, everybody knows that most businesses are gone in the first 5 years because they can't get funding, right? They figure out the formula and then they run out of cash, right? And then everybody says that if you're out here building business credit, if you're not out here building business credit, then you're wasting every transaction your business records, right? Every single purchase, right? Every single purchase you make, every single order you fulfill, you're wasting it if you don't have business credit. Everybody says that. So most entrepreneurs want to build business credit as quickly as possible. Would it be okay if we showed you a way to get business credit built out, no money down, plus an immediate up to $10,000 in immediate operations capital? You know, if you want to really think this thing out, I mean, I know you may have had some bad experiences in the past. I know you might think you don't qualify because you may have challenges on your credit or you've been turned down in the past. You probably even have a limited knowledge of how building business credit works. I know I did, but I'm going to tell you something. The reason that a lot of us have challenges on our credit as entrepreneurs is because we're overextended. The way business credit works versus personal credit, everybody, and I cannot wait till y'all come to this quick little 20-minute thing we're going to give you. Make sure you got pen and pad. But see, with personal credit, the more you use, the lower your score comes down, right? But with business credit, the more you use, the more they give you, right? So what you have to understand is that we can even get you to a place where because when you're in your market and you see two businesses, they're doing the same exact thing, but for some reason, this other one just seems to be killing it. You see them scaling, you know? I want you to think, it's not because they have the complexion of exception, you know? It's not because they have the complexion of connection where we have the complexion of rejection and all of that. Sometimes it's just that you're looking at business credit. Business credit's why they have a second location. Business credit's why they have a company car. Business credit's why they have a marketing budget. And you live in a land of opportunity, y'all, that was built from slave. Like, I don't want to get too, right? But the reason this country has such a surplus of capital is your forefathers. I'll just leave it at that. It is a tragedy if you're not taking advantage of this stuff, y'all. We're even going to show you how you can get to a point where you can take your personal credit, transfer it to your business credit, okay? And because of the system I told you, your personal credit goes up and now your business credit skyrockets too. I mean, you're going to get your mind blown with this seminar. Anything I'm leaving out, Mr. McCambridge?
No, that we're going to give them everything in the breakout session, you know, but real quick, for those who may not come to our breakout session, because I know there's other ones, I want you to understand that there's three different ways that you can fund your business if you're a startup business or expansion. If you're trying to expand your business right now, if you didn't know this, number one is equity financing, or you're going out and finding somebody that's going to get some equity in your company to give you some money. Most of the time, you want to stay away from that unless you're looking for somebody else to help. You can leverage to be able to grow. Number two is cash flow financing. That's how most people finance their business, with the money they're earning to be able to try to expand. A lot of people have a tough time. Number three is debt financing. That's what we're talking about. Most people are scared of debt, but we're going to help you learn how to leverage that debt so you don't have to worry about those different things. So I want you to think about expansion. Expansion in 2021. I know we kind of sound like we're trying to persuade you to come listen to us, but we're very passionate about what we do. We've helped tens of thousands of people all across this country, and we plan to help you as well. So expansion in 2021, and that's what we're going to help you do. So come and see us at our breakout session. Thanks, Sheena.
Awesome. Thank you, guys. So as you see, it's going to be a lot of great information shared in their breakout room. We're going to go ahead and move expeditiously to our keynote speaker. We're very excited to have this guy. A lot of you guys know him, and if you don't, I'm going to read his bio and you can get to know him. But we have Mr. James J. Bailey, and we are excited to have him as he talks about how we can move forward in this environment post-COVID. And so I'm going to go ahead and read his bio, and then he's going to go ahead and drop some nuggets for us. So James J. Bailey is committed to living by his personal motto, build as we climb. Change agent, thought leader, entrepreneur, and emerging philanthropist, James M. Bailey has dedicated his life to serving others. James serves as president and CEO of the Russell Center for Innovation and Entrepreneurship, honoring the great legacy and visionary business leadership of Herman J. Russell Sr. He will lead the development of the largest center in America, driven by impact, dedicated to empowering Black entrepreneurs and small business owners over a 50,000 square feet building designed to inspire ideas, create jobs, grow companies, and increase wealth in the community. An Atlanta native and diehard Georgia Bulldog, James has proven a track record of success, recognized by three U.S. presidents for his leadership and community efforts. In 2012, James was one of the eight Americans honored at the White House as a champion of change, following in the footsteps of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Dedicated to service, James is a National Point of Light Award and Presidential Lifetime Volunteer Service Award recipient. James has served on numerous boards, including the Metro Atlanta and the Georgia Chamber Board of Directors, the Atlanta Beltline TAD Advisory Committee, a Georgia Forestry Foundation trustee, and chairman of Citizens Trust Bank's Next Generation Advisory Board. A graduate of Leadership Georgia, Leadership Atlanta, and the Regional Leadership Institute. James is a recipient of the coveted Whitney M. Young National Community Service Medallion, the Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Drum Major for Service Award, a New Leaders Council Fellow, a member of Alpha Phi Alpha, and the 100 Black Men of Atlanta. James and his wife, NBC News correspondent Blaine Alexander, currently reside in East Atlanta. Ladies and gentlemen, help me give a warm welcome to Mr. James J. Bailey, our keynote speaker for today.
Hey, what's going on, family? We're going to shorten that bio, though, Ms. Robinson. Wow. Hey, folks, I'm so glad to be here. I got to shift roles a little bit. For those that know me, you know that I'm having a daughter in July. And literally 20 minutes ago, I was in a breastfeeding course at Northside Hospital and had to burn down 85 to get here to be with you. But I'm glad to be here. Shout out to our leader, Melvin Coleman. Thank you for the opportunity. Thank you, Ms. Robinson, for that introduction. I'm just excited, y'all. Man, we're Black and we're in Atlanta, and we have the opportunity to do something that history will never forget. I feel very confident that Atlanta will be one of the most quintessential cities for the next 25 to 50 years. We have it all here. I've spent significant time in Silicon Valley with all of my companies that support us out there. I've been to Cambridge with MIT and Harvard Research Triangle with Duke, UNC, love what they're doing in Nashville. Love what they're doing in Austin, Texas. But none of them are as cool as Atlanta. Where else can you go from Andre 3000 to Ambassador Andrew Young? We have more corporations here, Fortune 1000s, more corporate innovation centers than any other city in the country. There are more Black enrolled college students in Atlanta than any other place in the world. And I think that more than anything, you know, organizations like yours, ours, Melvin, I got to pay my dues, brother. I want to make sure we're paid up in this space. But when I say organizations like the Black Chambers, we got to realize Black folks were in an economic pandemic before COVID-19. And before this great awakening in the world where the whole world felt that things were not fair and that they needed to make an account for Black people and Black organizations, the Chambers were here before that. The Chamber saw a need to bring our companies together. And I think, you know, with the title, I guess, of today around how we making the pivot in COVID-19, we stay the course and remember more than anything else that we need community. I love the brothers before, I love to connect with you, the energy that you guys brought about access to capital. I know Matthew Coleman really well around access to capital, but I will tell you the thing that I think we need more than even capital is community. We need each other more than ever right now. I think that we are absolutely stronger together. The African proverb says, if you want to go fast, go alone. If you want to go far, go together. How can we figure out how through community we become more powerful? I'll spend a little bit of time talking about who I am, where we are, but I can't talk about the Russell Center without talking about the man. And people that have heard me talk have always heard me talk about Herman Russell because he was a great inspiration for me. But if you're doing business in this city, make no mistake, you need to tip your hat to Herman Russell. He's the brother that integrated the Chamber of Commerce on the city and the state level. Brother built half of the skyline, helped underwrite the civil rights movement. When 100 students got locked up during the student movement, the only real civil unrest in Atlanta to happen on Atlanta soil, they made one phone call, one man bailed them all out. If you have a big house over in Southwest Atlanta, you better understand, you better thank the Russells. And looking at when the mayor literally built a physical wall, and for those of you that aren't from here, there was literally our own Berlin Wall in Atlanta, Georgia, mandated by the mayor, saying Black people on Peyton, north of Peyton Road, do not even think about crossing. He was so diabolical that he had Black people build this wall to keep Black people out. Herman Russell and six other families bought a cattle farm and built a community to give Black working class folks and professionals a dignified place to live, and they called it Collier Heights. Surrounded by doctors, lawyers, educators, working class folks, if you have that kind of concentrated community of powerful, positive affirmation, you get Keisha Lance Bottoms, our current mayor. She believes that anything is possible. You get Killer Mike, who believes everything is possible because he was surrounded by community that believed in him. And if you think about the space that we're in right now, we talk about the Russell Center. Many of you guys are in real estate or touch the real estate world. You got to put it in context. Think of a Black man 74 years ago who spoke with a severe speech impediment, having the audacity to build a headquarter building that is 50,000 square feet in a full city block wide in the heart of downtown Atlanta. For you real estate folks, that's impossible today. And he did it 74 years ago in the heart of the Jim Crow segregated racist South. Not only did he build his headquarter building at 504 Fair Street at the corner of Fair and Northside, he did it intentionally because back then, Black students couldn't go to the University of Georgia. They couldn't go to Emory, they couldn't go to Georgia Tech. So they would come from all over the country to matriculate at the AUC campuses. He knew that those students, as they matriculated, they needed to see the physical embodiment of something that could happen, the possibilities of people that look like them. So he built his headquarters directly across the street from the AUC. And even to this day, even after his death, H.J. Russell & Company is still the largest Black-owned construction firm in the country. Concessions International, the largest Black-owned airport concessionaire hospitality in the country, and number six overall. When you start to talk about the impact of one person surrounded by a collaborative community, you start to think about Mr. Russell and even how it impacted me. Because it's not often told. I was a kid that grew up in South DeKalb County. Anybody here from the east side understands there's a difference between downtown Decatur, where y'all might go walk around and have brunch, but you cross over Memorial Drive and you start getting into the deck. And it's a little bit different over there. That's where I grew up, Glenwood and Columbia. But I used to steal my mother's car at 14 to drive around Southwest Atlanta because I didn't believe Black people could live in houses that looked like that. I happened upon a house with a tennis court and a swimming pool. Mind you, Herman Russell had a swimming pool inside his house in the 40s as a Black man, where young Dr. King used to go over and swim and get away from the world and figure out how he wanted to change the world. And I learned about this guy, Herman Russell, and he was inspirational. He was a businessman that always controlled his own narrative, and always controlled his own destiny. It was always an entrepreneur. I think our time is now, guys. The Russell Center at 54,000 square feet, we have now confirmed that we are building the largest center in the world, dedicated to growing, scaling, and developing Black-owned businesses. It is a place where I want to bring all the best resources in the world under one roof, and I've been working my ass off for the past 2.5 years. Because for those of you that have been with me along this journey, I believe Brother Coleman, in the earliest stages of the Russell Center, you had me, you know, address this august body. And we were just a whole bunch of wires and dust and dirt and wood and a hollowed out shell of a building. In 2.5 years, we've raised a little over $33 million to help bring this thing to fruition. In a little over 2.5 years, we've gone from one staff person to eight. In a little over 2.5 years, we've built a new curriculum. We'll be launching a new website next week, a new faculty. And we're now at the point where we can really deliver on the promises we made to the community to provide access, opportunity, and exposure to our people unapologetically. Anybody that knows me knows that I love Atlanta. And I love Atlanta so much that I can be honest with her. And it brings me to tears sometimes when I think about the realities of our city. Although in many regards, we are the Black Mecca, but in Atlanta, Georgia, we are still the worst city in the country for income inequality. We're the worst city in the country when it comes to economic immobility. A child born in Atlanta, Georgia has less than a 4% chance of reaching the upper middle class. And let's make no mistake, there are no poor white neighborhoods in the city of Atlanta. In the Atlanta public school system, there are no failing Latino schools. The people that are driving these deplorable statistics look like us. And if you're going to talk about moving Atlanta forward economically and being afraid of having a conversation about race, you're being intellectually disingenuous in your approach to try to move the needle. You're not having a real conversation, because if you talk about class in the city, you get race for free. And you cannot tell me that all of the brilliance, all of the genius, all of the talent lives in Buckhead. Wrong. I guarantee there's nobody more innovative on the planet than a single mother with two kids making 17 grand a year. The way she thinks, the way she problem solves, her grit, her determination, how does she smile at Christmas when she knows there's nothing in the bank? That kind of brilliance, that kind of genius that lives on the south side of every city, I'm a firm believer, and people have heard me say it, the only difference between Bankhead and Buckhead is access, opportunity, and exposure. You show me a dope boy on the west side, he understands import, export, wholesale, retail, supply, demand, customer retention, territory. It is time for us to now see value in our own reflection, to start seeing value in our communities, because oftentimes, unfortunately, the only value add proposition for success with us is how far we can move away from our community. I go from being a manager to an executive vice president, I feel like I gotta go to Sandy Springs or Alpharetta or Johns Creek, rather than building right where we are. You know, part of my task is exactly that. How on the west side can we create a space so special that we don't have to go to Buckhead to experience anything nice? The technology, what we offer, the learning, the access, the capacity building, all is in one space for us, by us, owned by us, in the community we serve. It's unfortunate in Atlanta, the Black Mecca. Outside of somebody's church or somebody's home, there aren't very many places where Black people can walk into and feel a real sense of belonging, a real sense of ownership. Because when I look at my skyline right now, I don't see many buildings in that skyline that we own or control. And people know that one of my mantras is, what do you own and what do you control? How do we change that? And I get help, you know, get really excited about organizations like the Chamber, because if you ever come to my office, it's tattooed on my body. I have hoodies and sweatshirts and t-shirts that say my slogan, WTFN. I think organizations like the Chambers, organizations like the Russell Center, we start to onboard, you know, folks like the AUC, we got the Gathering Spot, we've got the makings of something special. And I don't think there's any other city on the planet that can get this right to make innovation inclusive, to make economic development diverse, to actually control the narrative when we start talking about community development and economics moving forward. Atlanta is uniquely positioned. Our city is it, but it's gonna have to come from businesses. When I talked about that slogan that's on my body, it's WTFN. Brother Coleman, I respect the call, and I won't say the F word, but it's why the F not? For all of the businesses that we have on this call, I was talking to Pinky Cole the other day, and I'm like, Pinky, you know, why wouldn't you be as big as McDonald's? Does McDonald's have people that are waiting six blocks down the block for 3 hours to get a hamburger? No, you have that special thing. Ryan, with the Gathering Spot, why wouldn't you be as big as Club Corps with clubs all over the country, maybe even all over the world? Why not? And for each one of you who has a business, as we start to think about the possibilities of things, it is time to elevate those dreams, find our tribe, and build within our community, because we have all of the solutions that we need. If we understood Black economic impact and how much of our dollar churns this American economy, we would realize that from our community, we could build businesses that rival the Fortune 1000, that rival the Fortune 500, that rival the Fortune 50, just us. But it's a certain level of belief that we must have that we belong, a certain level of belief that our businesses have the capacity to grow to the scale where we can hire our own. It's no secret, guys. Black businesses hire Black people. And we wonder why there's a wealth gap. And why there's not representation in the C-suite is because those people with authority and power aren't hiring our people. And sometimes it's not just racism, it's radical indifference. And sometimes radical indifference is more powerful than racism, because racism says, Jay, when I see you, I hate you. But radical indifference says, you know what? I don't even see you and I don't even care. So you're not in my spheres, you're not at my clubs, you're not playing golf with me. So guess what? You don't even matter to me. And then we come up with a slogan like Black Lives Matter, because before, Black people didn't even show up on the radar. So you know what? While we fight to join their table, I've just gotten a really firm stance. Let's start building our own. Let's start looking at our systems that are designed to combat their systems. This pandemic will end, this racial tension that we're all feeling will quell. And guess what? We're gonna need more than just symbols of hope. We're gonna need institutions that manufacture it. Folks like the Chamber, organizations like the Chamber, centers like the Russell Center, I hope to be institutions that literally manufacture hope for our people. How do we undergird the self-esteem, the self-confidence, the belief? If we try to create programs that are only informative and not transformative, we won't make the mark. We actually won't move the needle. Informative does one thing, yes, and it's good to have information, but transformation should always be the goal. If we ignore the loneliness, the depression, the isolation that every entrepreneur has felt at some point when we're trying to build entrepreneurs, we won't move the needle because we're not focused on the whole person. In any business, the most powerful asset in that business is the person. Every big business was once a medium-sized business, was once a small business, was once somebody's silly idea that most of the people around them did not believe in. And as Black people, we know the narratives, and I've not met you all, but I guarantee a lot of us have had similar situations as business owners and entrepreneurs. That ain't gonna work. Why would you do that? Boy, you went and got that college education. Go get you a good job. Man, that's crazy. You know, most businesses fail in 3 years. All of this negative energy and noise that we get, and we don't get enough positivity to undergird our self-esteem and self-confidence that makes us believe. I'm a firm believer that as good as revenue or new jobs creating is a trajectory and a metric and a measure for a business's success, you show me a founder or an owner's well-being, and I will tell you that it is as important as revenue created. And we got to start taking care of one another. And I think that community piece is real. For every business in this chat right now, I guarantee there are three or four of you that could collaborate, do things more efficiently, and actually increase your revenues if we kind of got out of our own way and start thinking of ways that we could do this thing together. You know, Melvin, it's an honor to be here. I know I'm trying to persuade you to take one of the offices that we're building out downstairs, because I want the Black Chambers in the building with a physical space, because I want to tell the community that we are here together. And there's no conversation that you can have with one that's not been had before you had that conversation, because I know for a fact that if they came together, we had the AUC connected to the Black Chambers, connected to the Russell Center, connected to the Gathering Spot, connected to the Urban League, connected to the 100 Black Men of Atlanta. If we started to build these communities, collaboration beats competition every day of the week. And if we in one way start to collaborate in a way where we start to marshal all of our resources, all of our ingenuity, all of our talents, we create something that history would never forget. And when I think about how we're able to do something that's a game changer, I was out in Silicon Valley and I just sat and thought about how much they have shifted the existence of the world just with their crew, and they do it on their own terms. I went out to visit the president and CEO of PayPal, and I thought I was being sharp, so I wore a sport coat. And as soon as I walked into his office, he told me to take my coat off. He pulled out some scissors. He cut it in half. He wrote me a check for $1,000, told me to go back home and buy another sport coat when I got back home. But when they're out here, this is not how we do business, Jay. I said, well, damn, they're doing business their way. They made their own table. And they told the whole world, either you get with us or you get left, get right or get left. And I'm thinking in Atlanta, we could do the very same thing without asking for permission. One of my business mantras is start eliminating the number of people that you must ask permission to be successful. If I gotta ask you, and I gotta ask you, and I gotta ask you, and I gotta ask you for me to eat, then something's wrong with that system. Let us start to eliminate the number of people that we have to ask permission to be successful. But my other mantra thinks about how we look at doing this for generations yet unborn. How do we plant seeds that will grow trees whose shade we may never sit under? Because right now, I tell you what, history never feels like history when you're sitting in it, and especially when you're making it. But what are we doing right now that can affect seven generations yet unborn with our businesses, our companies, our collaborations, the things that we build? Ms. Robinson said it in my bio, but it's real. My mantra, my motto is build as we climb. What are we doing right now? Not to help another person up. No, what are the institutions that we're building so long after we're gone and we don't have a hand to actually pull someone up? There's stairs over that wall that we faced before we even got there. They walk over that wall that we were so challenged by. Our ceiling becomes their floor. As business leaders, that's got to be our mantra. We got to start thinking outside of ourselves. It's bigger than the Range Rover or the big house, because the cost of perception is killing our community. It looks wealthy, but it ain't wealthy. And the perception of power or the proximity to things actually is now the goal rather than transformative change. Because I tell you what, 71% of Black people in our city are liquid asset poor. If they had a $2,000 emergency, we could not satisfy it with our own resources. So the new poverty that we see in this city is not just a shack on the west side. The new poverty is a 5-bedroom house, all brick, 3 cars in the garage, but don't have $2,000 in the bank. That pressure to show up in the right car or wear the right clothes because so many in our family said we could not be successful, that cost of perception continues to kill us, because although I may be successful and make $500,000 a year, my debt load is so high trying to keep up with this perception that my disposable income is so low that I can't make any real moves. I'm just in this perpetual cycle of moving water from one side to the other, and we never actually grow. If we brought community together and shedded some of that pressure, I said it was okay to be vulnerable and not pull up in a certain way. I said it's okay to build. It's okay to spend 5 years spending nothing so that the next 5-10 years after that, you can do everything. If we normalize that with a community, what could we do collectively? And so I get excited. I get really excited about the possibility of things. COVID-19 has shown us more than any time before we need each other. COVID-19 has showed us, now that we've been away from each other for so long, how much we yearn the closeness, the collaboration, the community, the covenant, the culture that we bring to the table. So if we use that energy, that yearning, that power, and we come together in a positive manner, take that momentum, take that inertia, take that moment and make it a movement. There is nobody on this planet that could stop us. And I guarantee that Atlanta, right here where we are with these metro chambers, will change the world yet again without firing a single shot. I'm always excited and honored to spend some time with the chambers. And I don't know, Ms. Robinson or Mr. Coleman, if we're taking questions, but I will say that next week you'll see the new launch of the RussellCenter.org, our new website, our new curriculum. If there are companies out that are interested in being stakeholders, look for a note that will go out on social media networks today, tomorrow, Monday. I believe we're taking on 75 new companies. We've got an incredible faculty that runs all the way from Tristan Walker to who else do we have on it? Dennis Kimbrough, you name it. We got some really heavy hitter, powerful people that are on our faculty now in a way that we didn't have 2 years ago. So join us. But it's not just about being a stakeholder within RCIE or the Russell Center. It's just really being a part of this collaborative community. I certainly want to always count the chamber as a part of the community that we serve. So thank you guys, and thank you for what you do every day to promote, build, grow, scale, strengthen Black businesses. Take care.
So Jay, just want to say a couple of things real quick. Many of us take for granted, because we know you, we heard you speak many times, and I'm looking in the chat, and I can tell that for I mean, there's 100 people on the Zoom right now. And for so many, this is their introduction to Jay Bailey. And so I told Sheena when your name came up as the keynote, I was like, hey, if you want to chill and be cool, don't call Jay, because this is a Black man that is going to go in. He's going to bring that fire. He's the one person that I know can go in more than me. And the whole ABC knows how big my mouth is. But when it comes to you, I take a back seat. So I just want people to understand, we are truly grateful, brother, because you're a very busy man. When the call comes to you, if you can do it, you will show up and show out. And that's real leadership. Almost doing it when you got so much going on and you really may not even feel like doing it, but you still show up, and you've made our event something that we will always remember. And you just need to know how much I appreciate you, brother. And I'll let Sheena determine if we're going to take questions, because we may be trying to get some time back and get back on schedule. So Miss Robinson, I'm going to turn it over to you.
Oh, wow. Jay, that was phenomenal. Everything that we were looking for to speak to our community. We won't be able to take questions because we are trying to stay on track, but please get connected with Jay. But Jay, just some notes that I want to make sure the people heard and take away. What I heard from you that I took away is that you need to connect to organizations, then collaborate with other organizations, and then together we can create that change that we need in the community. And then also stop looking wealthy and let's actually be wealthy. And the new poverty is because of the cost of perception is killing us, that we're trying to maintain for family and people who don't even care about us. And so, Jay, I just want to appreciate you. You dropped it like I expected. You know, I had a committee. We voted. We wanted to bring you in. We appreciate you for accepting the invitation. And you delivered, brother. So thank you so much.
Y'all pulled me away from my wife in a breastfeeding course for our newborn baby to be. So y'all got to be important. But for everybody, if we're not taking questions, find me on LinkedIn. It's just Jay Bailey, J-A-Y-B-A-I-L-E-Y. You know, again, we're stronger together. So let's go farther together. Thank you, Sheena. Thank you, Melvin. Thank you to the whole body. I look forward to collaborating and connecting with you. It's our time. Let's go do it.
Absolutely. We'll definitely have to bring you back.
Of course.
And we want everybody to make sure that they go to the Russell Center. Many of us are very familiar with it. But again, you know, 100 people on the Zoom, there are several who are like, I don't even know what that is. You got to find out more about the Russell Center. Jay, is the website still rcie.org?
That's the thing, guys. And I see my boy Corey Henry, who's been with us from day one. I see your brother and Rebecca Ratliff. I got a lot of friends on the call. I didn't really look down. Hey, darling. Yeah, so it's changing, Melvin. Everything's new. Remember 2 years ago, we ain't had nothing. We were just dust and sticks. We're $30 million in the game. We got a full plan to redo the whole building. The website is changing. It will become russellcenter.org or therussellcenter.org. If someone goes to rcie.org, it will still take you there. But the name change comes because we're now more focused in our mission. The Russell Center for Innovation and Entrepreneurship will be no more. It will become the Russell Innovation Center for Entrepreneurs. The study of entrepreneurship means very little. But when the focus is on the entrepreneur, that's when power happens. And that's why we're changing the name, changing all of this. So stay tuned. Follow me on LinkedIn. You'll get some notes. But it's on. I got a serious focus. And over these next 2 years, I'm looking to raise another $30 million for our community. And I don't know if there's any force on the planet that's going to stop me from doing it.
Awesome. Right. I'm fired up. All right. So this summit has just been so powerful. I don't know what you guys have been taking away, but we've had some powerful conversations, and I don't want them to just be conversations. I want us to move forward. Like Brother Bailey said, you know, we talk a lot, we get excited. But that first step is to be a part of an organization. Sometimes we need that accountability. So you need to connect with the right people. And if you're trying to do it by yourself or with your friends who's still on the same level, it probably ain't gonna happen, but we definitely got to get connected with some movers and shakers such as Mr. Jay Bailey and make sure we actually take our, not only our people, but the next generation to the next level. I feel a turn is taking place after COVID, and it's definitely a chance for us to take advantage of it and get us back on track and be one of those communities that are not at the bottom
but work our way up and make it to the top. So I'm excited. We're going to go ahead and move back on to our schedule. And we have our one of our sponsors who actually sponsored the event today. And we're going to hear their presentation. And then after their presentations, we're going to go into our breakout sessions. We have those five breakout rooms. And so those will be coming up shortly. But we want to bring up Mr. Clevelon Galloway with Elevon. And they were actually our sponsors for this event. And so we're going to hear about them and then we'll jump into our breakout room. So without further ado, I'm going to go ahead and give the floor over to Mr. Galloway.
Hello, good afternoon, everyone. If you can hear me, shake your head. I haven't. Okay, great. So first thing I want to do is thank Melvin for the invitation. Thank you, Sheena, for the gracious introduction. And I'd have to thank Melvin for putting me behind the keynote speaker, Jay. That has brought great angst to my heart, but I'm gonna plow through that. We decided to pick the Atlanta Black Chamber as something that we would sponsor here at Elevon, and it was kind of a no-brainer. When you look around Atlanta and you look throughout the country, grabbing a hold of this organization is something that was evident to us that we needed to do. And this is our first calendar year being with the chamber, and we look forward to a lot of great things to come. I do not know. I wonder if you guys can see my screen.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. All right. So who is Elevon? So we're a credit card processing company. We're owned by U.S. Bank. U.S. Bank bought us, say, 12, 13 years ago. We're a top five global processor in the world. So that's a huge footprint. 2 million customers, 6.6 billion in transactions, and 450 billion in processed revenue. Numerous recognition, numerous awards. We pride ourselves as being the top credit card processing network, the most reliable network, and the most customer-centric network in the industry. I myself, just so you know, I've been with the company since 1996. I've served in the capacity as sales rep, team lead, and now I'm a sales manager of 16 people and in the Costco channel. So if you're a Costco member, you want credit card processing, you will call me. All right, just a few things. Some businesses do not take credit cards and others do. Most do. The reason is because consumers pay that way, quite frankly. There are 2.8 billion credit cards in circulation in the U.S. 70% of Americans own at least one credit card, and the average 2.7 cards per individual is the last statistic that we saw. And of course, the balance is over 5,000. People typically spend more with credit than they do with cash. That's, you know, if you're walking around with a credit card and you're impulse shopping, then you're going to extend that credit onto that card. That's just the way it goes. Now, in terms of solutions, when we think credit card processing, most often we think there's a credit card terminal sitting on a desk. You walk up and you hand them your card, or for instance, you'll go to a website and pay there. Now for our face-to-face transactions, we're moving towards a software as a service mode where it's more of a POS system. And with that, you get a low cost of entry. It's upgradable. So as technology changes, security increases, you basically can, through an application on a smart device or through an API on a computer, you can upgrade the system and bring it to compliance or bring in those extra features that you're going to need to manage your business. So this is the move that you're going towards. So if anybody's moving into credit card processing, I definitely would tell you to start out with the software as a service, because you're not investing in any hardware that's going to become obsolete. Just a little nugget. It's flexible. You can do things like, you know, accept payments mobily. You can transfer this payment mechanism onto your website and different things like that. And so it just keeps your costs down and it puts you in a position of being, competitive in being able to accept all forms of payment from any customer. I'm sure most of you would say, I'm going to take money however I can get it. And this helps you do that. Of course, we do have our standard terminals, and I mentioned e-commerce. With the pandemic and the onset of people not being out and about as much, definitely there was more online shopping going on, and we're poised to be able to support that as well. We also have safety features, which basically the big thing used to be they were hacking the big box stores and just, you know, grabbing customer information and cardholder information and going out and just committing fraud left and right. As the big box businesses started protecting themselves, guess what? It comes down to hacking into our smaller businesses. That's where the money is now. So as we grow our businesses from small to medium to large businesses, we need to be just as conscious of security as those big box stores are, because the big box stores, they can handle a breach. Most small business, most medium-sized businesses cannot. So whatever process you look for, make sure that their system supports secure transactions, tokenization, encryption, and things along that line. And for those who are looking to get into the business of accepting credit cards, there's very few requirements. Basically, there is an application process. It is subject to underwriting, and it's based on either personal credit or business financials. You don't have to have stellar credit. Just have to avoid things like bankruptcies, charge-offs, et cetera. And of course, you have to have a legitimate business, and that goes without saying. And you can find us at elevon.com, and there you'll be able to either apply, call in, get information. You'll be able to browse the website. It's pretty robust and can give you a really good idea of what Elevon has to offer. So this is not the most exciting arena, I'm sure, but we are very, very proud of our relationship with the Chamber. We're going to grow and foster this relationship. We're going to get out in the community as much as possible, and we're going to make Black businesses what they should be. Thank you.
Kevlon, thank you so much, man. Looking forward to working with Elevon, and we really do appreciate your organization supporting the Black Chamber. It's very important. Thank you.
My pleasure.
All righty. And Mr. Galloway, your screen is okay. Thank you so much. So that was phenomenal. I think so far everything's been going great. I've really been enjoying